We all know that Elon built Starship with one single end goal in mind: to make humanity a multi-planetary species. But we actually like to say a multi-world species, because we shouldn't forget the moon, which is not classified as a planet, but almost as big as a planet. And to that end, Elon wants to build a fleet of 1,000 starships in order to colonize the moon and Mars.
Now, while the moon is only 2 days away, which will not pose any problems for the voyage, a 6-month trip to Mars, on the other hand, comes with many, many problems, such as how to overcome zero gravity, how to protect against cosmic rays, how many people can actually fit into Starship for a Mars trip, and how could Starship get to Mars faster? So let's look at the first of these problems, namely the weightlessness, or zero G, and how we could create artificial gravity in Starship in order to arrive healthy and safely at Mars.
Now, there are many studies published in peer-reviewed scientific journals analyzing which detrimental effects a zero-gravity environment has on the human body. From countless long-stay experiments in orbit, such as Scott Kelly's extremely long stay of 342 days aboard the ISS, or Valery Polyakov's 437-day world record stay aboard the space station Mir in the 90s. We have a lot of data on that topic, and we put the links to some studies in the video description. So what are some of the worst effects of weightlessness on the human body? Well, reduced immune function, reduced blood oxygenation, a higher risk for cardiovascular disease, and even possible adverse genomic and cognitive changes, meaning possible reduced intelligence. In addition, eyesight is also decreased. Then also bone and muscle loss, which can be counteracted by exercising to some extent. But this is not enough to completely stop it. The calcium from the bones dissolves in bloodstream, then leads to a higher risk of kidney stones. So there are some quite severe detrimental effects of weightlessness onto the human body. And we know that currently a trip to Mars on board of Starship is estimated to take about 6 months. This is a very long time, which is long enough so that we will certainly witness some of these detrimental effects on our future Mars settlers. Now, of course, we don't want people to arrive on Mars in extremely bad shape, not even being able to stand upright or to perform the simplest tasks. And we don't want our future Mars settlers to suffer from any negative long-term health effects. Therefore, it's in our opinion highly advisable to create artificial gravity on board of Starship for future trips to and from Mars.
But how can it be done? Well, we don't have artificial gravity technology yet, even though some conspiracy theory people, of course, would immediately want to make us believe that. But there is not a single conclusive peer-reviewed paper out there with an experiment which has been verified and also repeated, which would have been able to create artificial gravity in a lab. So then we only have one other option: rotation. We have to rotate Starship in some way in order to create artificial gravity by means of centrifugal acceleration. So how could we accomplish that? Let's look at some possibilities.
One, rotation along the longitudinal axis. Of course, it would be the easiest to just let Starship rotate around its longitudinal axis. After all, Starship's crew quarters have an interior diameter of 8 meters. Unfortunately, this is a quite small diameter, even smaller than the famous centrifuge from 2001, A Space Odyssey, which had a diameter of 11.5 meters. Now, in order to achieve a 1G effect in such a small diameter, we can do a quick calculation and we get 15 RPM. The value is quite high. However, newer research based on data from centrifuge training indicates that with some adaptation time and training, most people might be able to adapt to such high RPMs. We will put the link to this paper into the description, which is highly interesting.
But we might also be able to reduce the gravity to, say, 0.5 g, then we'd already be at 10 rpm, which probably would be a lot easier for most people to adapt to. And 0.5 g, even though only 50% of Earth gravity, certainly is a lot better for the body on a 6-month trip than 0 g, right? Our awesome viewer Joff even made some drawings how the interior of Starship might look like to scale. Now, instead of rotating the whole of Starship, his suggestion is to have only the crew sections rotate. Of course, in both cases, we would need gyroscopes to stabilize Starship in order to avoid it wobbling around chaotically in space. We have to say we really like his idea, as it would be absolutely doable, simple, and elegant. It would not require a high degree of engineering sophistication as other possible solutions would. The only downsides, of course, would be that we would have quite high RPMs, which might take some time to get used to, and we wouldn't be able to make effective use of all the interior space of Starship. But we should certainly keep this idea very high up as a viable possible solution to solve the rotation problem for Starship. And another solution would, of course, be
2. Rotating Starship along its short axis. Here we would also need to use gyroscopes to stabilize the rotation. We know that Starship is quite large, right? In fact, it's 50 meters long. That means that should we rotate it around its short axis, and of course also carefully balance the weight distribution such that the two ends of Starship have the same weight, we could work with a much bigger rotation radius, namely 25 meters. In this case, we would get a much more comfy 6 rpm for 1g, or 4.23 rpm for 0.5g. Now this would of course be a bit weird, since the crew quarters then would have to be mounted upside down, because the rotation would press the people into the nose cone direction, and the viewing gallery on board of Starship, as it is called, would feel like the bottom, where we would also feel the strongest gravity. The crew quarters further towards the center would feel less gravity. So rotating Starship along its short axis is certainly an interesting solution. But getting the weight distribution right here might be a problem. But there are more solutions.
3. Docking 2 Starships together at the aft section and rotate them. Now it gets really interesting. Why only one Starship when we can use 2 at the same time? And we know that for orbital refueling, they dock already aft to aft. Therefore, why not dock them and let them rotate around their common center of gravity, which would be exactly at the docking endpoint. Here we would not need to carefully balance the Starship, because both Starships would be identical with identical cargo weight and crew complement, therefore we wouldn't need additional delicate balancing efforts. Also, an additional plus would be the even larger rotation radius of now 50 meters. This means 4.23 rpms at 1g and 3 rpms at 0.5g. There is an excellent tool, by the way, called SpinCalc, link in the description, to quickly calculate the rotation speed for different g factors and radii. Here, we would of course still have to build the crew quarters upside down, but the effect of different gravities for the crew sections and the viewing gallery would be decreased compared to a single rotating Starship. Also very good solution. What others are there?
4. Tethering 2 Starships. Now this solution might require some additional effort to reinforce the Starship nose cone section and also some quite strong Kevlar tether. But the idea is simply to tether 2 Starships together and to let them rotate around their common center of gravity. We could, for example, make the tether 100 meters long, so that we would get a rotation radius of 50 meters at the nose cone of Starship. This again means 4.23 rpms at 1g and 3 rpm at 0.5g. We could make the tether even longer and thus get even smaller rpms. This idea would allow Starship's crew quarters to be built in regular fashion, so not upside down, and also to achieve quite low rpms. But of course, it would imply higher risks, because if the tether breaks, that would be extremely bad. And also we need some seriously reinforced Starship nose cone sections, or in general a very sturdy and rigid Starship hull, in order to withstand all the centrifugal force. But certainly also a very interesting possibility. But wait, there's even another one.
5. Arranging a rotating ring around Starship. Now this here certainly represents the ultimate solution, but unfortunately of course also the most difficult one to realize. We would need to construct a habitation ring made out of, let's say as an example, 4 Bigelow BA330 habitat modules in orbit, and then dock the habitation ring with Starship in orbit. We could experiment with different radii. A radius of between 15 to 30 meters, for example, might turn out to be best regarding construction cost and G value. 4 Bigelow habitat modules would offer as much as 1320 cubic meters of interior volume, therefore more than doubling the available volume of Starship, which is less with 1000 cubic meters. Each of the modules will be connected to each other, but also to Starship, via 2 meter diameter tubes through which people could get from Starship to the modules, or vice versa, or from one module to another. Not too dissimilar from the Endurance spaceship in the movie Interstellar. Now of course this solution would require a much higher engineering effort and would have higher costs than the previous rotation solutions. However, this here would also increase the living space of the astronauts, therefore allowing for more people to journey to Mars. We personally would put the sleeping quarters inside Starship, so the crew would sleep in 0G, because while sleeping one doesn't need a lot of space. So the limited volume aboard Starship should be okay for up to 100 people. And then on average about 25 persons during waking hours per BA330 module, which would serve as a common meeting area and also offer working space or space for activities of all kinds, all of course in a comfy 1G environment. Oh, and the Bigelow ring would be left of course in Mars orbit, waiting for the next Starship for the return trip to Earth. The habitation rings would of course always remain in orbit and never land on a planet, and they would be in constant circulation from Earth to Mars, and then back from Mars to Earth, of course every 2 years, when there is a launch window.
So which solution to the zero-G problem is in your opinion the best?
We're curious to know, so tell us in the comment section and we'll discuss with you, of course.
And this is the first episode of our Fixing Starships Flaws series. So if you're new to our channel, don't forget to subscribe, such that you don't miss any future episodes.
So this was the JS Space Report, which we now also do on Fridays. And then I would say, on to the future!